Hello friends, welcome to a new lecture today on renal cell carcinoma, also called as hypernephroma, which is also called as Gravitt's tumor, which is also called as clear cell carcinoma, which is also called as internist tumor. So these are the different names which are seen for renal cell carcinoma. So what are the etiological features of renal cell carcinoma? It can be hereditary. In the hereditary, the most common manifestation, the most common syndrome which is associated is von Hippel syndrome. Von Hippel syndrome is a syndrome which has renal carcinoma. That is most commonly bilateral renal cell carcinoma. It is common in von Hippel-Lindau's disease. And it can also occur in tobacco smoking. And then sometimes, this is not hereditary. Yeah, hereditary if it's in von Hippel-Lindau's disease and whenever there is chromosomal aberrations. And also there is a syndrome which is associated with renal cell carcinoma, which is called as Bert-Hogg-Dube syndrome. This is Bert-Hogg-Dube syndrome. This is most commonly associated with renal cell carcinoma. And acquired, it can be because of tobacco smoking, or it can be analgesic nephroma. Analgesic nephropathy can progress to renal cell carcinoma. There can be cortical renal adenoma. So even this can progress to renal cell carcinoma. So these are the different lesions which can progress to renal cell carcinoma. Sometimes whenever there is cystic diseases of the kidney, any cystic diseases of the kidney, these will also increase the risk of renal cell carcinoma. And sometimes exposure to arsenic, heavy metals can also cause renal cell carcinoma. So these are the different lesions which can cause renal cell carcinoma. So what are the clinical features that are seen in a patient with renal cell carcinoma? Before we go to that, we will see the spread of renal cell carcinoma. One, the spread of renal cell carcinoma is through the following means. If this is the kidney, there is tumor here, right? So first, it can spread into the surrounding structures. It can spread to ureter, it can spread to perinephric tissue, perinephric fat. So that is the local spread. And then it can also spread through the bloodborne, either through artery or through vein. Most commonly, it spreads through the vein to inferior vena cava, renal vein. So this is inferior vena cava. Okay, it spreads to inferior vena cava, and in the inferior vena cava, if you see the thrombus, the tumor which is there, that tumor will get attached to the wall of the inferior vena cava, and it forms secondaries here, and even from the inferior vena cava, it can go to right heart, left right atrium, right ventricle, left atrium, left ventricle, and from the right ventricle, it can even go to the lungs. Okay. The thrombus which is there, it can go to right inferior vena cava, and from there to right atrium, then right ventricle, and then pulmonary arteries, and from there it can go to lungs, and it can form cannonball secondaries in the lungs. So it can cause cannonball secondaries in the lungs. Okay, this is one more. And one more thing is, it can even cause secondaries in the long bone. Okay, sometimes the renal vein may get obstructed. See, if I have to say, if this, let me draw a diagram. I'll use other pen. Yeah, this is for kidney. This is the ureter. So, this is the renal vein. Okay, this renal vein, inferior vena cava. So, this is right side. On the left side, this is the one. The left side, this is the renal vein draining into the inferior vena cava, and there is even testicular vein which is coming and joining the renal vein. Okay, now this will go up. This is the heart, and from here there is this thing, and there is lungs. This is the lungs, okay? Yeah, so the tumor which is coming here, it is reaching the inferior vena cava and it is going to the heart. From there, superior vena cava, from the right atrium, right ventricle, and from there to the lungs. And here it causes cannonball secondaries, which I have said, that is one. And second, if it is entering here, it can obstruct the left renal vein. It can obstruct the left renal vein, and as a result, there can be back pressure. And because of the back pressure, here you will have testis, and this is the scrotum. And because of the back pressure which is exerting here, this can cause varicocele. Okay, left-sided varicocele, because there is already thrombus here, which this left-sided varicocele is irreducible. So this can be seen. So sometimes the lymphatic spread, it is through para-aortic lymph node. The lymphatic is to the para-aortic lymph node, that is lymph nodes around the aorta. So this is the spread of the renal carcinoma. Now, how are you going to, what are the clinical features? I forgot to tell about the clinical features. The clinical features which you see are, clinical features, you see pain in the loin, that is one, and you see hematuria, and there is renal mass which is moving. So this is the triad. One is hematuria, the other pain in the loin or palpable renal mass. Palpable renal mass. So this is the triad which you see in renal cell carcinoma. So the mass in the loin, it moves with respiration and it is mobile. It is nodular, it is hard, and there is, on percussion, you see a dull renal angle, and you will also see a resonant band in front because of colon. Okay, so it moves with respiration, it is mobile, nodular, hard, dull, it has dull renal angle, and it is resonant, it has a resonant band in front. So sometimes there can be atypical presentation. Why is there an atypical presentation? As I have said, there are metastases to the lung. So because of lung metastasis, there can be cough and there can be hemoptysis. Okay. Sometimes there can be pyrexia of unknown origin. Okay. Pyrexia of unknown origin can be seen. Sometimes there can be, metastasis to bone. So because there is metastasis to bone, there is anemia. And erythropoietin can be increased second. Because there is anemia, this can increase erythropoietin. Because of increased erythropoietin, there is polycythemia. So these are the different features which we see in renal cell carcinoma. Sometimes whenever there is renal liver metastasis can be there. So this liver metastasis also causes jaundice. Okay. Because of bone metastasis, there can be bone pain. Okay. And then there can be, as I have said, kidney tumor. So kidney tumor, it produces renin or calcitonin. So because if it produces calcitonin, it causes increased calcium, that is hypercalcemia. So these are the different clinical features which you see in renal cell carcinoma. And how are you going to investigate the case? Investigations, first you do urine microscopy for any casts or RBC casts if there are present. And you'll have to do ultrasound abdomen to see the mass in the kidney. How is the mass? And then what is the texture of the mass? Are there any calcifications? All those can be found by ultrasound abdomen. Confirmation is by CT scan. This is confirmatory. This CT scan also tells us the status of the renal vein. Whether there are thrombosis in the renal vein. Those are found by CT scan. And you can do chest X-ray to find out the pulmonary metastasis. You can also do bone scan to know if there are any bone metastasis. For tumor thrombosis in IVC, the best scan is MRI, where you do tumor thrombosis in IVC. To know that there are tumor thrombosis in IVC, this is the best scan, which is MRI is the best. Okay. Now, how are you going to treat the renal cell carcinoma? renal cell carcinoma if you have to treat, if there is carcinoma in a particular area, you know, if the tumor which is less than 4 centimeters, and if there is bilateral renal carcinoma, or if there is only one kidney in the person has solitary kidney. In such cases, you will have to do partial nephrectomy. Or you'll have to either do nephron sparing surgery. Because you can't remove both the kidneys, but if both the kidneys are completely involved, then you will have to do complete nephrectomy total on both the sides, and you'll have to transplant a kidney. This is done only and only when kidney transplantation facilities are available. Kidney transplantation is possible. Then one more is, which is the treatment of choice, is radical nephrectomy. Radical nephrectomy, in this you will remove the kidney and the tumor is removed, kidney is removed, and also the perinephric tissue which is there, that is removed, and the adrenal gland which is present over the kidney, even that is removed, and the ureter, if you see, you will remove 2/3 of ureter, okay, and also there is diaphragm here, all the lymph nodes attached to the crust of the diaphragm are removed. So what structures are removed in radical nephrectomy? In radical nephrectomy, you will remove the entire kidney with the tumor, perinephric tissue is removed, ipsilateral adrenal gland which is there, that is removed, and the ureter, which is 2/3 of the ureter, is removed, and even lymph node from the crust of the diaphragm is removed. So these are the different things which are removed. So in radical nephrectomy, we remove the entire kidney along with the tumor, and also the perinephric tissue is removed, ipsilateral adrenal gland is removed, and ureter proximal 2/3 is removed, and the diaphragm with the, not the diaphragm, diaphragm is there, but the lymph nodes which are below the diaphragm, that do below the crust of the diaphragm, they are removed. So these are the different treatment options which are available, and even you can do radiotherapy and chemotherapy can also be done. Okay, these are the different treatment options which are available for renal cell carcinoma. So I think you guys understood about the renal cell carcinoma. So thank you guys for watching my lecture. If you have any doubts, please comment it in the comment section. If you feel something is inadequate in this lecture, even then comment it in the comment section. Thank you for watching my lecture. Thank you.